と共同通信社の太田です。ちょっと拙い司会になるかとは思いますが、最後までなるべくたくさんの質問を皆さんからお受けしてですね、建設的な議論というか刺激的な議論にしたいと思っておりますので、どうか何卒ご支援のほどよろしくお願い申し上げます。あとは座ってやらさせていただきますので、私2003年イラク戦争が起きたのとほぼ同時にワシントンに参ったんですね。でそれから4年ほどいましてですね、まあもう死後になったと思うんですけども、悪の枢軸という2002年のかの有名なブッシュ大統領のステート・オブ・ザ・ユニオンがありましてですね、一般教書演説で悪の枢軸という言葉が出てきて、まあイラク、イラン、北朝鮮と出まして、4年間ワシントンにいてひたすら書いてた原稿はほとんどこの3カ国の原稿であったっていうのが、まあ、当時の思い出なんですけども、ワシントンに行ってすぐアドバイス受けました。北朝鮮問題を取材するならぜひ会うべき専門家がいる、この今日メイン の、まあ、スピーカーであるキース・ルースさん、まあ、キースがその一人だったんですね。2人会えって言われたんです。2人の人に会え、1人は共和党のキース・ルース。ここ今日はバイオが詳しくルースの、キースさんのバイオ出てますけども、まあ、ルーガーさんの片腕、側近中の側近ですね、外交委員長を長く務めたルーガー上院議員で、もう1人は今日ひょっとしたら後で、このステージにジョインしてくれるかもしれないんですけども、もう1人会えって言われたのが民主党サイド、今のバイデン副大統領のまあ、外交問題の側近であったフランク・ジャヌージ、この2人だったんですね。でそれ以来私キースとはまあ長年の付き合い、まあもちろんその取材で随分お世話になったということもあるんですけども、まあいろんなそのまあ私生活も含めて胸襟を開き合う関係でしてですね、ただ1回だけ煮え湯を飲まされたことがございましてね。と申しますのが、2004年の正月、まあ、ワシントンの自宅で酒飲んでもう寝てたんですね。もう正月だからいいだろうって、もう どこも日本のメディア特ダネ書かねえだろうって、こう酒飲んでこうなんかあっていい正月だなんてやってたらですね、 USA Today という、まあ、アメリカの、まあ、全国に行き渡る新聞がございまして、これがもう大スクープ放つんですね。2004年の1月だったんですが、もう本当正月の末が取れる前だったんですけども、US コングレスのオフィシャルが突如北朝鮮のニョンビョンの核施設を訪問するというですね、まあ、特ダネだったんですね。で記事を読んでいくと、なんとその今私が申し上げた2人の名前が出ている、キース・ルースとフランク・ジャヌーチだったんですね。で当時は大変北朝鮮がまた新たに核開発活動を再開させまして、 NPT から脱退するといってですね、大変緊張局面にあった。そういった中で北朝鮮は、まあ、メッセージを送ろうとしたんだと思うんですけれども、まあ、米議会のキーパーソン2人、キースとこれから来るかもしれないフランク・ジャヌージを招いた。で私はまんまとその USA Today にすっぱ抜かれたんですね。でうわーやられたと思って二日酔いだったんですけども、朝携帯を見たらちゃんと留守番電話が入ってるんですね。なんだろうと思って留守番電話メッセージ聞いてみますとね、キースの声が入って、これから北朝鮮行くからって入ってんですね。でまあまあ USA Today にこう抜かれて煮え湯をまあいわば飲まされたんですけれども、まあそれでも大変律儀な方でして、私もいろいろ取材をしていたんでですね、やっぱりこう一つアドバンスウォーニングというかですね、まあちょっとしたノーティフィケーションをくださったというですね、僕はそれ以来まあなんとこの方は義理がたいというか、日本人のその日本人でいうところの人情に厚い方だなと思いましてですね、こういった方がやっぱりアジアの政策、対日政策、そして我々にとって非常にその安全保障の重要かつ喫緊な課題である北朝鮮の核問題をちゃんと議会からウォッチしてくださってるっていうのは、僕はこれは非常にありがたい、日本にとっては大変重要な友達でありそして戦略的なアセットだというふうに認識した次第です。若干長くなりましたが、今の、説明で若干皆様方に、キースの人柄とかですね、まあ、そういった 特別な経歴をお持ちだということがご理解いただけたと思うんです。あとは私の長い話よりも、キースの、ぜひ今日のスピーチを楽しんでいただいて、後から私一つだけ質問しますけども、その後に皆様方から多くの質問を受けしたいと思います。
Today it's my humble privilege to be with you and I express appreciation to officials of the Sasakawa Peace Foundation for this opportunityto visit on matters related to North Korea. The content of my presentation reflects my personal comments. As an American, I express appreciation for the U.S.-Japan alliance, but more importantly, I would like to convey admiration for the warm relations between the people of Japan and the United States. I was pleased earlier this year to participate in a seminar regarding U.S.-Japan cooperation in Southeast Asia, which occurred at the Institute of Southeast Asia Studies in Singapore, and was jointly sponsored by the East-West Center, the Sasakawa Peace Foundation, and the Japan Institute for International Affairs. This was one of a series of meetings bringing together American, Japanese, and Southeast Asian experts and practitioners to consider alliance cooperation in Southeast Asia. The main areas of focus on this project have been how the U.S. and Japan together can address security challenges such as maritime disputes and transnational issues, support the region's economic integration, and further strengthen ASEAN as an actor in regional affairs. But today, our focus is on North Korea. As a matter of background, the U.S.-based National Committee on North Korea is comprised of a diverse group of Americans who represent American organizations working on the ground in North Korea, as well as experts on topics ranging from nuclear weapons to economics to human rights, and former U.S. diplomats who have negotiated with North Korea. While their individual views tend to vary, the NCNK membership is dedicated to promoting principled civilian engagement between North Korea and the United States. Well, it has been over 60 years since the Korean Armistice Agreement was signed, but in a technical context, the war continues. It has also been over six decades since there were first questions in the United States Congress about North Korea having atomic weapons. During an April 1956 hearing of the U.S. Senate Foreign Relations Committee, U.S. General Lemnitzer of the Far Eastern Command, during an exchange with Senator Smith of New Jersey, said that indications in the press about North Korea having atomic weapons probably were connected to North Korea's use of an atomic simulator, a machine capable of producing a mushroom-shaped cloud similar to that resulting from the detonation of an atomic weapon. So now, 60-plus years later, the nuclear-related discussion of North Korea continues. An approach to address the issue embraced by several countries was the multilateral six-party talks process. The late American diplomat and statesman James Lilly, then affiliated with the American Enterprise Institute, wrote in 2004 that, and I quote, "The six-party talks hosted by China provide the most effective means of resolving Pyongyang's nuclear threat and of putting it on the path of economic reform. China, the United States, South Korea, Russia, and Japan have already agreed on four basic principles. Number one, no weapons of mass destruction should be allowed on the Korean Peninsula. Number two, North Korea is in a desperate economic condition and needs both economic reform and humanitarian aid. Number three, there will be no preemptive military attack. And number four, the negotiations must be multilateral. End of quote. Well, this was a good faith statement on the part of Ambassador Lilly, embraced by many at the time. However, what was unclear to six-party talks proponents was that the American emphasis on denuclearization did not and does not correlate with China's priority of regional stability. China has determined that stability, as defined by Beijing, trumps elimination of North Korea's nuclear program. Consequently, many American officials in Congress and elsewhere have determined that China is unwilling to leverage its economic ties and aid to North Korea to achieve denuclearization. 6 months after Ambassador Lilly's article, former National Security Advisor Brent Scowcroft and Daniel Poneman wrote in the Wall Street Journal, and I quote, "The six-party talks designed to deal with the North Korean challenge have stalled. Pyongyang has gained effective control and pacing of the crisis, boycotting the talks and cranking up its nuclear program. The world is powerless to assess the accuracy of its escalating assertions of nuclear weapons capability, as North Korea has kicked out all international inspectors and monitoring equipment." The quote continues, "We must not wait for Pyongyang to decide whether and when it is ready to negotiate, for such delay could be fatal to our interests and to those of the world. The U.S. should articulate a vision of a future where no North Korean weapons threaten the world and no governments threaten North Korea's security." Condoleezza Rice began this process with her Tokyo acknowledgement of North Korea's sovereignty. "The U.S. vision should be painted with bold, clear strokes, including security assurances, economic cooperation, and diplomatic recognition in exchange for North Korea's complete and verifiable elimination of its nuclear weapons program," end of quote. And Mr. Januzzi, would you please come up and join us?
さっき申し上げたフランク・ジャヌージさんがわざわざ駆けつけてくださいましたんで。
So, and by the way, Dr. Ota was very, he was extremely pleasant.
Too kind.
Too kind. He was too kind about you. Actually, Dr. Ota prefers Mr. Januzzi. But, no. Sorry. President George Bush did offer a security guarantee to North Korea, whose officials, for one reason or another, did not fully test the president's offer. Well, today, 9 years after Scowcroft and Poneman published their proposal, 14 years after I began working on North Korea issues, and over 60 years after the Senate Foreign Relations Committee discussed the possibility of North Korea having atomic weapons, this is the 1953 piece, I would like to share with you 6 points, 6 observations on my part pertinent to U.S. policy toward North Korea, which I have observed during my time in Washington. And I should say Mr. Januzzi may or may not have the same 6 points, so this is my own perspective. Number one, there is no pressure on the President of the United States from a grassroots constituency to assertively tackle issues related to North Korea, except for the issue of human rights in North Korea. Point number two, for years, U.S. presidential administrations and sessions of Congress, as well as unofficial Washington, meaning think tanks, academia, they've been comprised of officials who fit into at least one of the four following categories. In other words, in every U.S. presidential administration and in every session of Congress and in unofficial Washington,
There have been and are, A, those who assert that U.S. policy should advocate and pursue regime change inside North Korea. Most forms of engagement are opposed and viewed as legitimizing the existence of the North Korean government. That's point A. B, there have been and are those in Washington who favor engagement with North Korea in consultation with the Republic of Korea and Japan to achieve denuclearization. C, there have been and are those in Washington who quietly accept maintenance of the status quo on the Korean Peninsula, thereby preserving what they view as a necessary buffer with China. And then D, there are also some, albeit a minority of perspective, who favor maintaining the status quo on the Korean Peninsula so as to ensure ongoing appropriations and investment in the U.S. military-industrial complex. Now, on to my point number 3 out of 6 that I've observed over the years. Whatever the policy approach, U.S. presidents are unable or lack the personal and political will to enforce consistency of North Korea policy application among key players at various levels within an administration. As one example, during a trip to North Korea where Mr. Januzzi was present, Vice Foreign Minister Kim Gae-gwan asked as to whether President Bush would truly provide a guarantee for North Korea's security as President Bush had earlier announced. We replied, we reaffirmed the President's commitment. Yes, President Bush was serious about providing a security guarantee. Looking at us in disbelief, the minister referred to a recent news article in an American newspaper, which reported that an unnamed Bush administration official stated that the U.S. was establishing a short list of possible sites within North Korea for direct military strikes. Point 4 of my observations. Today, a majority of officials in the executive branch, in the White House, and the Congress have determined that North Korea is not interested in final resolution of the Korean War and denuclearization. They point to the pattern of North Korean behavior, of threatening behavior or provocative actions, followed by a charm offensive, followed by threatening behavior or provocative actions, a reoccurring cycle. North Korea fatigue in the Congress will likely be reflected by ongoing opposition to additional U.S. government-sponsored food or humanitarian assistance, as well as by strong skepticism about any new U.S. diplomatic engagement with North Korea on the nuclear issue. And in the next Congress, there will likely be legislation introduced reinforcing sanctions and intended to discourage, if not eventually terminate, U.S. NGO assistance within North Korea. Point 5. It is my opinion that North Korean leaders have determined that an American president does not possess the will or the ability to honor the terms of an agreement between the two countries. Point 6. North Korean officials also often do not believe that we mean what we say in terms of the U.S. Through the years, U.S. presidents, secretaries of state, defense, members of the Congress, and so on, have spoken of North Korea's provocative behavior and how there will be consequences for crossing red lines, that we should bomb Yongbyon, and so on, and so on. Lack of follow-through on the part of the U.S. after having drawn the so-called red lines over the years has resulted in North Korean leaders believing that red lines are of no consequence. Now, separately, the United Nations Commission of Inquiry report on human rights and ongoing review by the UN has facilitated North Korean engagement with other countries on human rights issue. Now, in reviewing unilateral approaches to North Korea, Prime Minister Abe is to be committed commended for his long-term commitment to bring home to Japan those citizens forcibly taken away from their families and homes by agents of North Korea. Prime Minister Koizumi also deserves commendation for his cutting-edge leadership, reflected by his travel to North Korea in an effort to bring home abductees. Some in the region and in the United States are concerned about Prime Minister Abe's discussions with North Korea, thinking that perhaps his initiative may undermine a multilateral effort to convince North Korea to eliminate its nuclear weapons program. Well, I hope that he is given the benefit of the doubt by peers in other countries. The abductees and their families are fortunate that Mr. Abe has made a priority of their situation, proving his long-term commitment toward their return, which has not been the case with all leaders of Japan. And it is important to note that North Korea appears to be engaging on this issue with leaders of Japan. An interesting parallel is the fact that approximately 8,000 Americans were reported as missing in action at the end of the Korean War. Over the years, successive U.S. presidents and their administrations provided diminishing emphasis toward requesting an accounting of these individuals from the North Korean government. In essence, the United States walked away. The often stated commitment of American leaders to, quote, leave no soldier behind, end of quote, has not applied to the Americans left behind and unaccounted for in North Korea. When North Korea is discussed in the regional context, the so-called six-party talks, as we earlier discussed, this is what often comes to mind: the countries of North Korea, South Korea, Japan, Russia, China, and the United States. However, the six-party talks have failed. What is the future process through which denuclearization, human rights, and other issues will be addressed? I don't have a precise formula. However, it may be instructive to consider other examples of constructive engagement. In that regard, I acknowledge the meaningful role of Mongolia, a country respected by North Korea, Japan, the United States, Russia, China, and South Korea. In addition to serving as a bridge between North Korea and other countries, Mongolia is a model of transition from a controlled to market economy. As Dr. Charles Kruskoff of the East-West Center notes in the November 2013 Asia-Pacific Bulletin, and I quote, Mongolian President Elbogdorj was the first foreign head of state to make an official visit to North Korea after Kim Jong-un assumed power in 2011. Political and cultural relations between Mongolia and North Korea have generally remained close since 1948, when Mongolia became only the second country to recognize North Korea after the Soviet Union, end of quote. In 2007, Mongolia hosted the Japan-North Korea Working Group meeting of the six-party talks. In 2012, Mongolia was the venue for Japan-North Korea governmental discussions. And then more recently, Mongolia was selected as the location for interaction between Japan and North Korea on the abductee issue. Mongolian officials note, and I quote them, that they are keen in contributing to Northeast Asian regional confidence, into Northeast Asian regional confidence building measures by offering a neutral discussion ground for negotiating parties, and it is the only country in the region that has no existing disputes with other countries, end of quote. Well, what about Mongolia serving as a future venue for multilateral talks on North Korea? Why not? Are seven-party talks a feasible alternative? Would Mongolia serving as a venue achieve confidence in negotiations on the part of North Korean leaders? Another option would be Singapore, which is respected by North Korea and the United States. Or, in the bilateral context, a new model would be to schedule concurrent talks between North Korea's Ministry of Foreign Affairs and their counterparts in the State Department of the U.S., between North Korea's military and their counterparts in the U.S. Pentagon, and between North Korea's security and intelligence apparatus and their counterparts in the CIA and DNI. In this model, these series of negotiations would all occur at the same time. One of the points held in common by North Korea and other countries is the reality of stovepipes in their bureaucracies. In any given country, including the United States, one government agency or department does not always communicate effectively with others. This has proved to be a very common phenomenon in North Korea, as individuals who've engaged in dialogue with that country know. The question must also be asked after 60 years as to whether fruitful, direct, bilateral talks between the United States and North Korea are at all a realistic possibility. Would adopting a model similar to negotiations between Aceh and Indonesia, brokered by former Finnish President Martti Ahtisaari, be a reasonable option? Well, the Chinese are to be credited with their ongoing willingness to host the six-party talks. However, in the United States for too long, many American officials in the Congress and presidential administrations were of the opinion that because of China's energy and food assistance to North Korea, over the long run, that China would persuade North Korean officials to dismantle and eliminate their nuclear program. As I noted earlier, this has proven to be unrealistic. China's top priority of regional security and stability does not match with the American goal of denuclearization in North Korea. While China has, on occasion, impacted North Korea's plans to proceed with actions that others would view as provocative, it is now the opinion of many in the U.S. Congress that China has acquiesced to North Korea's ongoing development of its nuclear program, as well as other weapons of mass destruction. Chinese officials, leading a sovereign nation, have convinced themselves of their ability to manage North Korea's policies and actions on matters related to nuclear weapons. Again, the six-party talks have failed. Additionally, some former U.S. officials have noted that China's role as host of the six-party talks reinforced Beijing's tendency, when the talks were ongoing, to value process over substance. For Beijing, it seems that the six-party talks were more about trying to manage the tensions, political fallout from North Korea's nuclear developments, than about achieving denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. China took on the role of a convener rather than an actor capable of offering carrots and sticks at the negotiating table. Now that 60 years has passed without resolution, the United States and North Korea appear to be no closer to achieving peace. After over $1 billion of U.S. food, humanitarian, and energy assistance to North Korea, official Washington is skeptical of further assistance, believing it will only sustain a government unwilling to have constructive negotiations toward the transparent eventual elimination of its nuclear program. Now that a series of Track 2 discussions are underway or planned between North Koreans, Americans, Europeans, and others in the foreseeable future, perhaps North Korean leaders are prepared for substantive discussions. Many in Washington are interested in knowing the ways that North Korea will demonstrate seriousness in negotiations. Whatever future path is pursued toward engaging North Korea, it now appears that the majority of countries anticipate that human rights will be on the table next to the denuclearization issue. North Korea is signaling it is prepared to enter into discussions on human rights issues. As we consider Northeast Asia and approaches to the North Korea situation, it is also important to acknowledge the Northeast Asia Peace and Cooperation Initiative proposed by President Park Geun-hye, which, as I understand, is not intended to target North Korea, but rather to create a regional forum in which North Korea could participate and through international input and cooperation find ways of addressing a range of domestic issues. President Elbegdor to Mongolia has also presented a regional confidence-building initiative, and I anticipate that Mongolian and Republic of Korea officials will connect to explore areas of common interest and methodology. It would be incomplete to have a discussion about Northeast Asia without reference to issues surrounding history and the revision of such. The regional temperature on history is reaching an inordinately high level. While leaders of various countries in the region spar over the facts and myths of history, they are being distracted from considering and addressing other issues of importance to the general population on a daily basis. We know of the areas of disagreement among Japan, South Korea, and China on history, but what do we know? Where is the public discussion about areas of agreement among these countries in addressing the direct challenges to the men, the women, and children, and the region as a whole? How are Japan, China, and South Korea working together in preventative ways to address common threats to their respective population in the areas of disease, global warming, and terrorism? Some say that cooperation on issues like public health is not important, to which I reply by pointing to the awkward and unprepared response within the United States when Ebola arrived. Actually, there are challenges which all in the region have in common and which span the ages of time. While in Singapore earlier this year, I came across a remarkable book at the Institute of Southeast Asia Studies entitled The Junk, J-U-N-K, Trade from Southeast Asia, covering the years 1674 to 1723. I'm grateful to the editor, Professor Yonio Ishii, for making the English edition possible. The book contains translations of interviews required by Japanese officials, Nagasaki, with the captains of foreign vessels entering that port from 1674 to 1723. For the Japanese, the visiting ships were windows to the world. As noted in the book, and I quote, "From the Chinese junks in particular, reports were expected on domestic political developments in China under Manchu rule, as well as on the activities of the different anti-Manchu rebel groups in and around the Chinese Empire. Ship crews originating in Tonkin, Champa, Cambodia, Siam, Ligor, Songkhla, Pattani, Bantam, and Batavia were also interviewed." End of quote. Well, through reading these books and going through the interviews, we learn that the people of Northeast Asia and Southeast Asia were faced with challenges identical to some confronting the region today. Contaminated water was a threat at that time, as were pirates, terrorists of their day. As the price of rice was low and people had an affordable food supply in whatever country, tranquility among people was often a reality. And of course, there was the issue, the challenge of the weather. So today, in 2014, I ask, what has changed? Well, I choose to be optimistic. While the headlines usually emphasize the divisions throughout the region, there are those in the countries of the region committed to working across borders to provide economic opportunity, alleviation of poverty, clean drinking water, nutritious food, and safe living conditions, while at the same time retaining their national sovereignty. The citizens of each country in the region expect such of their leaders. In March of 1956, U.S. Secretary of State John Foster Dulles testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee regarding his recent trip to Asia in 1956. The Secretary provided a country-by-country report of his travels to the committee. Regarding Korea, Secretary Dulles testified, quote, "At Seoul, I had what I think was the most warm and generally participated in reception they have ever had there," end of quote. Regarding Japan, Secretary Dulles stated, quote, "From Seoul, I went to Tokyo and had the best talks which I've ever yet had with Japanese leaders," end of quote. And so it is today. The U.S. alliance with Japan and the U.S. alliance with the Republic of Korea reflect not only commitments of national security, but are also statements of the bond between the people of the United States and those in Korea and those here in Japan. And again, I want to thank you for having me.
でこれからちょっとクエスチョン&アンサーに行く前に今日フランク・ジャヌージさんがお越しになってます。ちょっと若干経歴を簡単に紹介いたしますと、彼はテキサスのオースティン、 Are you from Austin, right? テキサスの生まれでですね、それでハーバードの JFK スクールを卒業されてですね、それで国務省に行かれて、でバイデン大統領のスタッフに確か2000年の前くらいから就任されて、バイデン副大統領、今副大統領ですけども、当時の上院外交委員長、それからないしは上院外交委員会の筆頭委員だったバイデン現副大統領の補佐官をずっと長く務められた。2004年のニョンビョン核施設の訪問はこのお二人が一緒に行かれた。共和党と民主党のまさに北朝鮮政策を立案するキーパーソンが実は二人今日並んでるっていうんで、ワシントンでもこういった光景私見たことがございませんでした。大変これはですね、珍しいというかありがたいというかですね、こういうのはめったにない光景なんで、ぜひ今日はフランクにも一つ質問を受け付けてもらってですね、ディスカッションを進めたいと思います。じゃあちょっとフランク、could you make some brief comment, you know, follow up the Keith's remarks, please, Frank.
ありがとうございます。Thank you very much, Masa. And I'm very sorry that I've arrived late. I was hosting an event at Keio University on U.S.-Japan space cooperation. But I am delighted to be here with the Sasakawa Peace Foundation, especially because I get to appear with two close friends, Masa Ota, who is the smartest journalist on international strategy in Japan that I know, and Keith Luse, who is my closest colleague and friend from the Senate. It's true that Keith is a Republican and I'm a Democrat, but I should tell you a brief story about one of our trips to North Korea. After a very long and frustrating meeting with Vice Foreign Minister Kim Gae-gwan that lasted more than 3 hours, he became tired with Keith and me. And he turned to us and he looked at Keith and he said, you are a Republican, but sometimes you talk like a Democrat. And you are a Democrat, but sometimes you talk like a Republican. Keith and I, in our approach to East Asia, have always tried to work very closely together. And this reflected the commitment of Senator Biden and Senator Lugar to a bipartisan American foreign policy with respect to East Asia. So I'm very pleased to be here. Let me just say, two observations about Keith's magnificent talk about the strategic situation in East Asia as it relates to North Korea. The first is that he touched upon the importance of finding common ground among the US, Japan, and ROK. And nowhere is this more important than on North Korea policy. If these three treaty allies cannot effectively coordinate and work closely together, then managing the threat posed by North Korea and promoting peace and stability on the Korean Peninsula is impossible. So we need to work together on the common interest, and I believe one way to do that is for the United States and South Korea to complement the humanitarian outreach that has been launched by Prime Minister Abe on the abduction issue, by enhancing their own efforts to find people-to-people and humanitarian issues to engage the DPRK. And for the United States, I think this may best be the missing remains of American servicemen, as my colleague Keith Luse has discussed. And for ROK, it may involve the family reunification efforts of North and South. I think working together, we can reduce tension on the peninsula and create a better environment for the resumption of security talks about the nuclear program. And I would be interested in whether Keith believes that that is a useful approach. And the second observation I want to make is respect to the core security challenge on the peninsula, which is the failure to end the Korean War, right? In 2012, I arranged a conference for Senator John Kerry to meet with all of the six party nations, including the DPRK, along with representatives of the EU and Mongolia in New York City. And at this conference, Senator Kerry made one very important gesture to the DPRK. And he told the DPRK representative, the United States has no permanent enemies. Right? This is a lesson that Senator Kerry learned from his own efforts to normalize relations with Vietnam, where he had served in the Navy. And you could see that the DPRK representative was very struck by this comment, because I think there is an assumption by many in Pyongyang that the United States is a permanent enemy. Right? And so my question to Keith is if, in fact, the key to denuclearization on the Korean Peninsula is linked to ending the Korean War, I would ask him to elaborate a little bit on his very innovative suggestion about parallel talks, concurrent talks, to address security issues, peace and on the Korean Peninsula, humanitarian issues, economic issues. Can this formula work? Yeah, thank you.
Rather than Mongolia being able to exercise diplomatic leverage, in my mind, Mongolia is in a position to offer something more important to North Korea, and that is Mongolia is in a position to offer North Korea a diplomatic hospitality. Mongolia is in a position where it can extend to North Korea an environment where North Korean diplomats may come who already hold leaders of Mongolia in high respect. There are years and years of relationship. And this is important, to be able to provide an environment where all participants in multilateral talks can come together and not be particularly constrained by concern or by issues related to present relationships. Regarding Mr. Januzzi's question, I would say that I have been fascinated over the years by the ongoing question of who is in charge in North Korea? Who, in fact, contributes to the decision-making process? To whom does Kim Jong-il listen? to whom does Kim Jong-un listen? I don't know of any American who can answer that question today. But what is evident is that within North Korea, there are sectors of government. There is the security sector. There is the military sector. There is the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the diplomats. There are other sectors. Now, if North Korea is like other countries, these sectors, people within these sectors, may in fact have varying influence according to the day or month or according to the topic. So if, in fact, it is impossible for us to determine the key advisors, the key players on, shall we say, denuclearization or this or that, then how in the world can we expect to engage in comprehensive negotiations, discussions, unless the key players of each of the sectors in North Korea are at the table? Now, North Korean officials might say no. North Korean officials might, and understandably, say it's important that all this remain in the channel of the diplomats. Okay. But at least the other sectors in North Korea, the military, the security, the intelligence officials, would know that others in the rest of the world were prepared to sit down with them and for them to have opportunity to have input into that dialogue and into that discussion. And for me personally, this is an important part of the equation that has been missing.
It's true that President Obama has spent 6 years of strategic patience with DPRK. The policy approach has been relatively passive. While the administration has focused on much more urgent priorities, restoring economic health, withdrawing U.S. forces from Iraq, and negotiating in an effort to prevent Iran from developing nuclear weapons. Because the Obama administration inherited a nuclear-armed North Korea, and because the diplomatic prospects of convincing North Korea to abandon completely their nuclear weapons have been very low for a long time. The Obama administration has simply not focused a heck of a lot of attention to this problem. To be blunt, the first special envoy was a part-time envoy who kept his job in Massachusetts while also being senior diplomat for North Korea policy. He's a very able diplomat, but he had very little to do. There is a danger that Obama will try, out of his interest in legacy, to reach some kind of a last-minute deal with the DPRK. But I think that he and his administration have learned from the Clinton administration and the Bush administration. Both of them tried for a last-minute deal, and both of them were embarrassed by the results. So frankly, I think that we are likely to see two more years of patience. On the second question, and then I think Keith will have thoughts. Red lines should not become red carpets. And it's true, as Keith has said, that China and the U.S. and Japan do not share the same identical long-term vision for Northeast Asia. And we have some different interests on the Korean Peninsula. But there are forces at work which should create opportunities for cooperation, even with those different interests. For instance, China ROK trade now, I believe, is on the order of about $500 billion. It's a huge economic relationship, and it is put at risk by DPRK instability. Yeah. China is also watching the US-Japan alliance become closer than ever before in every area, including space, including cyber. One of the factors driving the US and Japan alliance closer together is our common response to the threat posed by North Korea. And I think there are many people in Beijing who would prefer to remove the North Korean threat and thereby remove one of the drivers of the enhancement of the US-Japan alliance. So even though China's interests may be different from ours, that does not mean that they cannot see value in working with us to try to achieve the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. So I think that is where we should take some hope, is that we do not have to have the identical interests in order to make common effort.
Red lines, a favorite of Washington politicians of both parties, domestic issues, foreign issues, red lines. The phrase makes a great headline in the home paper or on the internet. In defense of people in Congress and in an administration, Republican or Democrat, when leaders of another nation engage in behavior viewed as either threatening to the United States or extremely provocative, there often are few options available. And so in the Congress, for example, as there are, shall we say, new events in Iran, North Korea, sanctions, new sanctions bill, more sanctions. And many are critical of Congress for sometimes introducing or passing sanctions bills that are not always fully considered. However, members have little else they can do other than vote for or against a resolution or a piece of legislation. They are limited. Mm-hmm. In the case of the administration, one of the challenges is the reality of democracy, in that every 4 years in Washington, or every 4 years in the United States, there's an election, and there's a new president, at least every 8 years. With new presidents come changes in policy. Same in South Korea. Same in Japan.
Except in Japan, it's every 6 months until recently.
No, be nice, Frank. You didn't have to say that. So I recall a time in the committee when South Korea's perspective approach to North Korea was very different than it is today. And so whoever is president, whoever is in the Congress, they have to be sensitive to the political realities in Korea, South Korea, and in Japan. What is important is that perhaps presidents, secretaries of state, and so on, perhaps they should measure their words more carefully. There are consequences. There are consequences to how North Korea interprets what we say or what we don't say. And you raised an excellent point. You know, people will say, well, North Korea, multilateral talks. North Korea will sort of peel off this country. They'll make a deal with this country, and then yes, they will. That's human nature. That's what happens in normal negotiations in countries, if you are trying to get the best deal possible. I don't know why we're surprised by this. I'm not talking about you, but in general, this is not a surprise. So if we are concerned about North Korea actually leveraging one country against another, that is an argument for bilateral talks with North Korea by the United States in consultation with Japan, in consultation with the Republic of Korea, China, and so on. So it's a personal opinion that multilateral talks in the six-party context have actually favored North Korea, have benefited North Korea over the years. And so that's why today, without endorsing one model over another, I simply shared a few examples of other models that could be there. In terms of legacy, strategic patience, I would just, in all fairness, and I think Masa wanted to ask me, what did I see as the benefits of strategic patience or the results? And in all fairness, I would need to refer Dr. Oda to the administration to ask that question to them. This is a policy that they have espoused. It's a policy they continue. And so out of respect to the administration, you would need to receive their response on how they believe this has worked. I totally concur with Frank's comments about the impulse of politicians in the White House, presidents, at the end of administration to be able to show, to be able to demonstrate action, leadership, whatever. North Korea, in recent weeks, as I noted, is interested in participating in a range of track 2 or track 1.5 discussions. What does this mean? I don't know. Some say, well, Keith, this is simply a response to the Commission of Inquiry. This is North Korea's effort to distract countries to in fact, achieve a more positive public relations effort. Maybe, maybe not. We don't know until we talk to them, until we test what they have to say. Now, having said that, a comment that I personally support Track 2 dialogues. I support Track 1.5. However, in the United States, we have a habit of Track 2, Track 1.5 talks. And so one group will have a meeting with the North Koreans here. There was a meeting in Singapore last week, I believe, Track 2s, friends of ours. And this is all well and good, but too often the organizers of the Track 2 talks don't talk to each other, all right? We will go back to Washington, and we'll call the administration and report sometimes. In the meantime, the North Koreans who met with these Americans in their Track 1.5 or Track 2 in Singapore, in Berlin, in Mongolia, wherever, the North Koreans are able to go back. They take very careful notes, and they are quite shrewd in their review, their analysis of these discussions. So I'm simply, I endorse Track 2 talks, but I'm simply saying on the American side at least, I think we have an obligation to start talking to each other more, and that's something that will come later on. An excellent question. To me, it's fascinating today as an outsider, to observe, in my mind, what appears to be a North Korea operating on two roads. On one road is the continued restrictions on the population, the continued actions by leadership against people they view as potential threats or enemies, purges, and so on. That particular road is not new in North Korea. The second road, however, is one where today's North Korean leadership, the leadership is allowing an increasing number of North Koreans to leave the country, to learn about the basics of business, to learn about how to transition from a controlled economy to a market economy, to learn about property rights, to learn about property allocation. Chosen Exchange in Singapore is one example of an entity that in the last 3.5 years has trained 350 to 400 North Koreans on the basics of business, international economics, etc. Today, as we meet at the University of British Columbia, there are 6 North Korean professors who are auditing classes on international economics. That brings to a total of 24 the number of professors from North Korea that have visited that particular institution. These are simply 2 examples of a reality where the leaders of North Korea are now allowing people to leave to learn the basics of business. Yes, they want hard currency. They need hard currency. But I'm simply suggesting to you, North Korea is on at least 2 roads today. I have no idea when and how those roads may converge or what the results will be. I cannot predict that. What I can say, however, is that for outside observers, whether they are organizations or countries, there is an opportunity to view all of this and to try to think through now, to anticipate what will these changes mean in the future. You think about the cell phones within the North. So it is inevitable that change is coming to North Korea. I cannot predict how that will reflect itself. But what I can say is that whenever this does occur in significant ways, we should not be surprised.
Mm-hmm. And just very briefly, I agree with everything Keith said. I would say I believe North Korea is a very rational actor. They want security. That often involves tightening up and closing their country to outside information and visitors. At the same time, they want prosperity and economic development. And they're struggling with how to do that within the confines of their commitment to their national security, surrounded by more powerful countries, many of whom are hostile to them. So I think they're very rational. And that means that we apply a rational actor model to them. If we want them to change their behavior, we have to either increase the cost of their pursuit of nuclear weapons and their destabilizing behavior vis-a-vis the South, or increase the incentives to induce them to pursue a more peaceful, open market economy track, or both. So far, we have had neither enough pressure nor enough incentives to convince them to change their behavior. And this is because even the open path for them holds risk. And if there was one thing I could say to this audience, it would be that we should remember that engagement and attempting to open North Korea to the international system, to information, to commerce, to travel, is not a gift to this system, because this system is afraid of many of those opening aspects. So the first question is a very complex one, and I don't have an adequate answer. But the gentleman seems to be asking, can the United States ever accept the existence of North Korea sort of side by side, living in peace with South Korea? I think the answer is yes, but. And the but is that the United States and the people of South Korea have expressed clearly, repeatedly, the desire to see unification on the Korean Peninsula. And we should not lie to North Korea about this objective. They are not stupid in North Korea. And they understand that when we say unification, they understand what we mean. So I think it's better to be honest with them and say yes.
And by the way, Mr. Januzzi will be running for office in the United States.
No, never. And on cyber, the gentle lady is right to be concerned. North Korea is among several serious emerging threats to the United States and other allied countries in the cyber realm. It is an emerging area of international law and international warfare. A cyber attack is arguably an act of war, but we do not respond with kinetic force to a cyber attack. That would be irresponsible. So the best solutions involve hardening our own defenses, as well as developing, to the extent we can, countermeasures, right? While accepting that this problem is only going to become more difficult, and that North Korea in particular wishes to exploit asymmetries, right, to deprive us of the assets that we rely on, especially even in space, for situational awareness, for surveillance, for communications, in the event of a crisis. So it's an extraordinarily serious problem. The Sony hacking event, I don't know if it was the DPRK government or not, but it just illustrates one dimension of a growing threat, and one which I know the U.S. government is focused on, but one which, frankly, is going to be with us for a long, long time.
On the first, and I agree with everything Mr. Januzzi said, on the issue of U.S. policy toward Korea, I would simply go back to my points in the presentation. Quite frankly, over the years, North Korea has not been among the top issues of concern in terms of foreign policy to the United States. And when I say over the years, I mean through the decades. In the last 10 to 15 years, this has changed. But quite frankly, there has been a mixed approach on the part of Washington toward North Korea. One of those approaches has been to ignore North Korea in the past. On the other extreme, there are those who've suggested in the past that the United States should engage in military action against North Korea. There has been, in my opinion, within the United States government, including the Congress, a lack of consensus on how to deal with North Korea. Typically, Washington, and I don't say this to be critical, but typically, Washington, especially the Congress, Congress is reactive as opposed to proactive. And part of that is by virtue of just the amount of business that Congress has to deal with. Mm-hmm. So until there's a crisis, until there is a missile launch or whatever, Washington has over the years tended to look the other way related to North Korea. That's changing now, but there is still, I believe, an assortment of perspective. On the issue of cyber, I think your concerns are warranted. The good news is you have plenty to write about, correct? Good for job security for you, is that right? However, you, in your question, you express this in a way of concern, of urgency. Good. But unfortunately, as North Korea ramps up its cyber capabilities, and if, in fact, North Korea engages in cyber attacks against the United States, the United States will then respond. The United States will then determine it is time to sit down and tell North Korea how this should not be occurring, this is a bad thing, and so on. In other words, once again, we continue the pattern of talking to North Korea after there is a problem. We speak to North Korea after the North Koreans engage in behavior which the United States views as provocative. That approach in itself is an encouragement to North Korea to engage in provocative behavior, in my opinion. So, my own thought is that the better approach is to have ongoing discussions with North Korea on a wide range of issues. Indeed, the nuclear issue should be at the top, but we must not limit conversation to that particular point. And I say that out of respect to U.S. negotiators and U.S. planners. I'm simply sharing a personal opinion today. But in conclusion, I would like to thank the Sasakawa Peace Foundation for hosting this forum. I'm especially grateful that my good friend Frank Januzzi was able to join us today. He is president and CEO of the Maureen and Mike Mansfield Foundation. And in a number of ways, we try to continue our collaboration, as I'm sure we will in the future. And Dr. Oda, thank you for a very touching introduction and for your taking the time to be with us.